Hi viewers, welcome to my channel. Today let us learn about heat. Heat is a form of energy that you know. And let us start with an experiment. You have to take an iron rod and fix some marbles on this one with the help of wax. And heat this one at one end. And after some time you will be seeing that these marble pieces are falling one by one. First this one will fall down, after that this one, and following that. So, the reason is that conduction, that means heat travels from this hot end to cold end. Means heat always travels from hot area to cold area that we learned earlier. Okay, now you can do one more experiment. You take a metal spoon and a wooden piece and keep it in the refrigerator. It is better to keep it in the deep fridge. Keep it for just 15 minutes or 20 minutes. Take out both and touch and feel which is more colder. Okay, it will be the metal piece. You have to do that experiment and then you should know, then you will be knowing that which one will be more colder. According to me, the metal piece will be more colder. So what may be the reason that the metal piece is more colder than the wooden piece? It is similar to that of when we are touching a hot substance, we feel hotness, and when we touch a cold substance, just like an ice piece or a cold drink or something, we will be feeling cold. So when we are touching a hot substance, the heat energy from the substance travels to our body, and when we are touching a cold substance, heat travels from our body to the substance. So you can say, in the case of metal, and we are taking wooden ones, in the case of metal, more heat flows out of our body to the metal, and in the case of wood, less heat energy travels from our body to wood. So that is because of the molecular arrangement, the difference in arrangement of molecules of both the metal and the wood piece. So whatever it be, we learned by these cases that heat energy always travels from hot to cold, means hot body to cold body. Okay, then how can we know that which body is colder and which body is hotter? We can know it from a quantity known as temperature. Okay, temperature says us which body is hotter and which body is colder. When you get a fever, doctor comes to you and check your temperature with the help of a thermometer, right? And if you are having more than 100 Fahrenheit, doctor says that you are having fever. So, temperature is the degree of coldness or degree of hotness. This says whether the body is hot. When we take an environment, let us take this room. In this room, different things are there. This board is there, shelf there, me there, and different things are there. This everything is in touch with air in this room. Okay, so in an environment, everything will be in contact to each other. So we say that is in thermal contact. So when two bodies are in thermal contact, from one body which is more hotter, from that heat will travels to the another body which is colder. So heat always travel from hotter body to the colder body. So until when it will happen? It will happen until both the bodies, or how many bodies are there in that environment, until that all bodies get the equal temperature, heat will travels. So heat always travels from hotter to colder until they get the same temperature. We call that temperature as thermal equilibrium. So we said that all the bodies are in thermal equilibrium. So what is thermal equilibrium? It is a state at which that body neither receives the heat or nor gives out the heat. So what is thermal equilibrium? It neither receives nor gives out. So thermal equilibrium is a state at which the body sitting in an environment neither receives nor gives out heat energy. Okay, so heat energy always travels from hotter part to colder part, or hot body to cold body. You can better understand about the topic if you do one more experiment. Take two tumblers, one is containing hot water and another one is containing cold water. Okay, first you have to introduce a thermometer in the hot water. So that time you will be seeing that suddenly the mercury level will be increasing, because the thermometer mercury is in thermal contact with the hot water. So that mercury will be getting the temperature of the hot water. After that, you replace that one into the cold water. When you are replacing that into the cold water, immediately you will be seeing that mercury level is coming down. Because now the mercury is in contact with the cold water. So mercury will be getting the temperature of that cold water only. So from this we can clearly understand that when it is in contact with the hot body, it is increasing its temperature, and when it is in contact with the cold body, it is decreasing, it is coming to that level. So up to when this process will take place, until when both the body, this cold water and this mercury, gets the equal temperature. So thermal equilibrium is a state at which both the bodies are having the same temperature. Okay, now we can define the heat. Heat is a form of energy that transits from a body which is at a higher temperature to a body which is at a lower temperature. And the unit of heat at SI unit is joules. SI unit of heat is joules. Then what is the CGS unit? CGS unit is calorie. Okay, CGS unit is calorie. We can say that 1 calorie is equal to 4.186 joules. You must be having then an idea about what is 1 calorie. Okay, we should know what is a calorie. So for knowing that, what you have to do is that, okay, let us suppose there is 1 gram of water taken in the tumbler. 1 gram of water. How much water? 1 gram water. Say it is in room temperature 31 degrees Celsius. We have to raise it up to 32 degrees Celsius. You must need energy. You must need energy for this, isn't it? So how much energy is needed for raising this 1 degree Celsius? That is called as calorie. So calorie is the amount of heat required, to raise the temperature, of 1 gram water by 1 degree Celsius. Okay, that is called as calorie. Okay, 1 calorie is equal to 4.186 joules. In the same way, temperature is also having the units. Temperature can be measured. For temperature, the units are SI unit is Kelvin and CGS unit is degree Celsius. That means zero degree Celsius is equal to 273 Kelvin. Okay, 0 degree Celsius is 273 Kelvin. That means how much is 100 degree Celsius? 100 degree Celsius is equal to 373 Kelvin. If anything measured in Kelvin scale, we call it as absolute temperature. Absolute temperature. This question may come for examinations. What is absolute temperature? So, absolute temperature is the measurement at Kelvin scale. Okay. So, 0 degree Celsius is equal to 273 Kelvin. Or 100 degree Celsius is equal to 373 Kelvin. Reverse. 373 Kelvin is equal to 100 degree Celsius. So, for examination, it is asked. 473 Kelvin equal to how many degree Celsius? You can subtract 273 from this. 473 minus 273. That means we get 200 degree Celsius. Okay, now we have to see, is there any relation between the temperature and also the energy of the molecule inside? So for knowing that one, you can do an experiment at home. It's very simple. You have to take 2 bottles. One is filled with hot water and one is filled with cold water. There will be food color at home. Have to introduce little bit of food color in both of the bottles and see the movement of that food color. In hot water, you will be seeing that very fastly the total water inside that one get colored. That means uniformly that spread out very fast, because molecules in the hot water travel so fast. But when you are seeing the cold water, the jiggling of that food color will be very less, because in this one the molecules are not traveling faster compared to the hot water. When the temperature increases, the motion of the molecule also increases. So we can say that kinetic energy is directly proportional to the temperature. When the temperature increases, the motion of the molecules will be more. Temperature is a factor that decides from where to where the heat travels. So for knowing that one, we will do one more experiment. We have to take a glass tumbler in which half of it is filled with water which is at 60 degree Celsius, and we have to pour coconut oil or any oil into this one without mixing with this water. Very carefully through the sides of this one you have to pour oil into that one. So it will be as 2 layers. Upper layer is oil and the down layer is hot water. This oil is at room temperature first. So now we have to introduce thermometers. You can keep a 2-hold lid for this one. We can introduce 2 thermometers. The one thermometer, mercury is touching the hot water, and another thermometer, mercury bulb is touching the oil. So at the starting, we can see that the thermometer which is touching the hot water will be having more temperature. Okay, it will be showing more reading. And the thermometer which is touching the oil will be showing less reading or no reading. Starting is. But after some time, you will be seeing that in this one, starting it was at 60 degree Celsius. So later you will see it is coming down, 59, 58, it is coming down. The temperature of the thermometer which is immersed in the water will decrease. At the same time, the thermometer which is in the oil, its temperature will increase. Until when it will happen? It will happen both the thermometer shows the same reading. Okay, what is the reason behind that one? When the thermometer, when here we can discuss about this oil and the water. Water is hot, but oil is colder compared to water. So when the water is hot, we know that the motion of the molecule or the kinetic energy is more for that molecules. So its temperature will be, temperature rise will be more. But oil, the it is at room temperature. That means its kinetic energy is low. But when it is in touching with the hot water, what happens? From, we know that thermal equilibrium, when two bodies are in contact to each other, from hot body, heat will travel to the cold body. So heat is the energy that is flowing, but temperature says that to which direction it is flowing. So here we say that it is traveling from hot water to the oil. How we know that one? From the temperature. So temperature says us that what is the direction of heat energy. Okay, now let us see, is there any relation between the nature of the substance and the temperature? Nature of substance and change in or rise in temperature. Okay, for this I suggest you to take a tumbler. Okay, you can pour water at 80 degrees Celsius into this. 80 degrees Celsius there is water. It contains water. Okay, now you can take two test tubes. One test tube filled with water. Filled means 50 gram water you take at the room temperature. Room temperature. This is water, and another test tube, take same 50 gram of oil at the room temperature. Okay, now these two, this is water and this test tube is oil, both of the test tubes introduce into this water which is at 80 degrees Celsius. And these both are at room temperature, say it is 30 degrees Celsius or something. So, we can, with the help of the stand, you can introduce this test tube into this water. Okay, both the test tube, one is oil and one is water. With the help of one hold rubber stopper, you can introduce thermometer and see the rise in temperature. Okay, this is clamped with the help of retort stand. And see the rise in temperature in both the thermometers. That means the thermometer which is immersed in water and the thermometer which is immersed in oil. Both oil and water, they are getting heat from this one. We know thermal equilibrium. Because both are in touch with, in thermal contact with the water which is at 80 degrees Celsius. So, in both, temperature will rise. But in which substance, whether it is in the oil or is it in the water, temperature rises more. We will be knowing that, by noting down, we can understand that one. In the oil, the temperature rise will be more. That means, according to the nature of the substance, the rise in temperature also changes. Okay. And also, we will know when whether the heat depends upon any other factors. Okay, now we learned that temperature depends upon the nature of the substance. Okay, now we are going to know whether the heat is depending upon any other factors. Okay, let us take 2 beakers. This contains 250 gram of water and this one contains 1 liter of water. Both are water, same substance. See the initial temperature with the help of the test tubes. Let it be, let it be 30 degrees Celsius, and this is also 30 degrees Celsius. Okay, now we are going to heat both. This will be heated and this also should be heated. Say we want to make it as 60 degrees Celsius or maybe 80, something. What do you need? In both these cases, 30 degrees Celsius I want to make as 60 degrees Celsius. Here 30 degrees Celsius I want to make it as 60 degrees Celsius. That means change in temperature is same. Delta T is same in both. Both I want to make 30 to 60. 30 to 60 means room temperature to 60. So change in temperature is same. But here the mass is different. This is 250 gram of water and this is 1 liter of water. Which one will need more energy or which will be taking more time to get heated up? So obviously the water which is more. So when the quantity is more, it needs more heat. So from this experiment we can say that Q is directly proportional to mass of the substance when the temperature is constant. Change in temperature is constant, not temperature, change in temperature is constant. Okay, let us also know when this heat depends upon any other factors other than this mass. Okay, for that I am going to do another experiment. I take both beakers contains 250 gram of water. Okay, same amount of water. This one 250 gram and 1 liter water. This is both 250 gram of water. I see the initial temperature with the help of thermometer. Say it is 30 degrees Celsius and this is also 30 degrees Celsius. Okay, both are heating. Both are heating. Heating started at the same time. And equal energy is giving to both. And we will be knowing that both are increasing its temperature. Same increasement. But I want this to 100 degrees Celsius. Means I need 70 degrees Celsius change. And this I want to make as 60 degrees Celsius. That means change in temperature is 30 degrees Celsius. Here I want the change in temperature is 70 degrees Celsius. 30 to 100 I need. And 30 to 60 I need. Which will be taking more time? 30 to 100 or 30 to 60? Obviously, 30 to 100 will be taking more time. So from this we know that Q is also proportional to change in temperature. Means when the mass is constant, I have taken constant mass, same mass, 250 gram of water, 250 gram of water. So when the mass is same, we understood that heat is directly proportional to the change in temperature. So Q is proportional to mass, Q is proportional to change in temperature. Let us combine both. When we combine this, we will get Q is proportional to M delta T. Okay, we want to join it with the help of equal sign. So, whenever we want to change a term into equal symbol, we have to multiply that one with a constant term. Here also I am multiplying with a constant. Yes. Okay, where S is nothing but the specific heat of the substance. Okay, S is nothing but the specific heat of the substance. We will learn what is specific heat. So, for easiness, we will write this as Q is equal to M yes, delta t. Okay, from this we got the formula for finding out the heat. Heat is equal to ms delta t. So from this one we can also find out the formula for s. S is equal to q divided by m delta t. Okay, now we can find out the units for specific heat. In CGS unit we will see first. In CGS unit, q, CGS unit of q means the heat is calorie, so it will be calorie CGS unit, calorie per, mass is gram, and temperature measured in degree Celsius in CGS system, so gram degree Celsius. Okay, we will see the unit in SI system. In SI system it will be q. We know that it is joule, joule per, mass is measured in kilogram, kilogram Kelvin. Okay, these all are very important. And 1 calorie per gram degree Celsius is equal to 4.186 into 10 power 3 joule per kilogram Kelvin. Okay, specific heat S is equal to q by m delta t, and CGS unit of specific heat is calorie per gram degree Celsius, and SI unit of specific heat is joule per kilogram Kelvin. And 1 calorie per gram degree Celsius is 4.186 into 10 power 3 joule per kilogram Kelvin. And we should be having an idea about what is 1 calorie per gram degree Celsius, or what is the specific heat formula we should know, definition we should know. Specific heat is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 unit mass of substance by 1 degree Celsius. Amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 unit mass substance, 1 unit mass substance by 1 degree Celsius. Okay, specific heat is very important. Okay, we learned before that temperature depends upon the nature of the substance. In the same way, specific heat also depends upon the nature of the substance. So when the specific heat is high, the rate of rise in temperature will be less. For example, water. Water is having high specific heat, so the rise in temperature will be less for water. So when the specific heat is increasing, rise in temperature will decrease. Okay, this specific heat depends upon the nature of the substance. Why it depends upon the nature of the substance? When we talk about a substance, the substance having molecules in it. These molecules showers different types of energy, like rotational kinetic energy, linear kinetic energy, and also potential energy, vibrational energy, and all. Means all these energies together we will call as internal energy. So when we are providing energy, internal energy, so when we provide that energy, molecules will be using that energy for different purposes. Suppose if it is using for increasing the linear kinetic energy, the temperature rise will be more. Linear kinetic energy, if the provided heat is used for increasing the linear kinetic energy of the molecule, the temperature rise will be more. So when the temperature rise is more, when the temperature is increasing more, what will happen? The specific heat will decrease. So the specific heat is having a lot of application in life. For example, oceans are the storehouses of incoming solar radiation. Having high specific heat, oceans can receive a lot of heat energy. And when we are discussing about the equator, it makes us to live possible around the equator, because oceans make the temperature moderate in that region. Having high specific heat, heat energy from the sun is absorbed by the oceans. Even though it absorbs a lot of energy, there will not be considerable rise in temperature for the water. And not only that, that energy which is absorbed, that will be transported to North Pole and to the South Pole. So around the areas around the North Pole and South Pole, also making it possible to live. So water is having that much application because of the high specific heat. Okay, then we can talk about the coolness of fruits. If you keep any fruit which contains a lot of water in that, that will retain its coolness. When we take out from fridge, it will retain its coolness for more time because of having the high specific heat of water. Because of the water in that will take more time to get heated up. Also, you can think about samosa. You all like samosas. The curry inside the samosas is hot even though samosa outside is cool, because the ingredients in the samosa is having high specific heat. And nowadays people are using copper bottomed vessels for cooking. The scientific application is also specific heat, because copper is having low specific heat compared to iron. Because of having low specific heat, it will get heated up quickly. So we need less energy to get heated up. But we cannot buy copper vessels, all copper vessels instead of iron vessels, because it is costly. So only if the bottom is copper, we can save energy because of having less specific heat for the copper. So there are a lot of applications for specific heat. You can also think about it. In the upcoming videos, we will be learning more about heat. Thank you. Thank you for watching my video.